All right, welcome to this video. It's sort of a final in the series. In this, we'll sort of zoom out. So far, we've taken a look at individual components and a lot of foundational theory, a lot of applications inside our GenAI ecosystem. In this, we'll get like a bird's eye view of how to go from zero to GenAI apps. And we'll take a look at how a foundation of an ecosystem looks like, how H2O approaches it, what our GenAI ecosystem looks like, and how you can go from zero to an app, and sort of our opinionated way around it. So let's jump into it. Here's what we think make for the foundations of a GenAI ecosystem. You would start with unstructured data. You'd start with documents. It could be web pages. It could be PDFs. It could be text files. It could be pretty much all over the place, like any machine learning project. From there, you'd want to prepare this. So many people forget this. Many people simply focus on just the fine-tuning part. But of course, you need to prepare this into question answering pair. And then you need different approaches how to tackle with this data set, even before you fine-tune. So once you prepared it according to your problem and according to your target, that's when you get to fine-tuning and what we call prompt tuning. So at this stage, you can look at how you want to store this data set in a vector DB. How do you want to prompt different models to retrieve this data set if you're just doing a simple RAG? Or you can look at fine-tuning your own LLMs over this. So you can create your own GPT, or you can have your own RAG system operating over this. What we think is a better approach is having a mix of both. So you fine-tune your model onto your domain data set. Let's say all of these are financial documents, right? So now you prepare them in a certain format. You remove some things, you prepare them, you pre-process them. From there, you create your own financial GPT. And you also store these documents that you care about. Now, at this point, your fine-tuned model sits over your RAG system. And this can live in an API, right? So you can simply work with an API that allows you to work with both the model and your stored database. I think that's how H2O also thinks. At the API stage is where all the GenAI apps can live. And this is where all of the GenAI app development can happen. You can also have LLM agents operate at the system. So again, it's a linear flow from going from data sets to GenAI apps, but the process can be cumbersome. So this is where a lot of our apps come into place. This is the ecosystem we sort of created. You've taken a look at a lot of these earlier, but we'll take a fresh approach and just refresh our knowledge before we take a look at the GenAI apps. Again, all of these are linked near this video. Please check them out if you'd like. To prepare your data set, we have our offering Data Studio, which works exceptionally well with the sort of data sets you'd want to work with for LLMs, right? So that is why a separate app in itself exists, because you'd want separate pre-processing or a separate pipeline for this entire thing. And it does exist. Once you've prepared it with Data Studio, you can fine-tune your model with LLM Studio. It's our offering that we call, that lets you fine-tune like a grandmaster. From there, you can have your own GPT hosted via H2O GPT. And the Vector DB becomes Enterprise H2O GPT. That's where you store all of your data for performing RAG. And all of these very conveniently are also offered by an API. So you can integrate them into your apps. In the next video, we'll take a look at a lot of these integrated apps. But for the first one in this video, I'd like to refresh all of these apps for you and just give you a bird's eye view now that you've had the chance to study all the fundamentals. So just to put a label on everything, Data Studio is where your data preparation happens. LLM Studio helps you fine-tune. Enterprise H2O GPT lets you perform RAG over these. And we also have Eval Studio that lets you evaluate all of these models. So in that sense, this becomes a complete GenAI ecosystem, right? You can go from zero to GenAI, if I may, like so. So let's quickly refresh our memory. We'll start with LLM Data Studio, which lets you curate, prepare, and perform ETL for LLMs. So again, you can curate, prepare, and augment. Remember this philosophy because that's what you'll see on the left, and that's the order we'll follow. When you go to the curate tab, this is the home screen of the app. Once I head over to curate, this is where you can create a new data set. So here you can upload data sets for different types. It could be question answer, different task types. It could be question answering, summarization, file summarization. Or you can also enter a web page URL. So enterprise. So Data Studio will itself crawl the website and prepare the documents by itself. You can also generate question answers once you've uploaded all of these. Once you've done that, you head over to the prepare page where you can see the different data sets and their status available here. So let's take a look at the top one. This is for website privacy, and it's just a question answering type data set. Data Studio lets you have this bird's eye view of the entire workflow, which means once you have the source data set downloaded, how do you want to clean it? How do you want to augment it, remove profanity, remove sensitive information? I hope this is where you sort of see why it's important to have this independent app of its own for LLM data preparation, right? Because this sort of allows you to remove all profanity, all sensitive information, which I'm sure any organization would not want going into an LLM. This exactly lets you do that. So I can click on any part of this, and again, you can create this workflow by yourself, but let's go to clean. And if I configure that, you can see the different options that I have here. I can remove new line characters, white space removal, lower casing, all that stuff. I can also decide how much profanity do we allow, the context length. So if you don't want, let's say, answers or questions above a certain length, you can truncate that. And you can also check if the questions are relevant. So when you upload your documents to Data Studio, it can automatically create or automagically create question answer pairs from it. Sometimes, since this is powered by LLMs, this process can also create very vanilla questions that you probably would not like. So you can also, you know, remove them by enabling this checkbox. So this is the entire workflow that you get, and you get an overview of all of your data sets here. From there, you can augment your data sets as well. You can improve their context, add extra rows, upload your own data, sort of improve all of these. So here you can see I can get a simple preview of all of this, and then I can go from there. So this again was a brief refresher of LLM Data Studio. Once you've done all of this, you can download the data set and you're ready to fine tune your LLMs. At this stage, you would head over to LLM Studio where you would import this data set by A, uploading or connecting it to S3, Kaggle, Azure Data Lake. And you can then get a view of your entire data set here. You can get a bird's eye view of the questions, the answers that exist here. You can get a visualization. And you can also get a summary of how many examples are there. Once you've done that, you can create an experiment from here. And if you watched the course, you might have noticed since the first time you might have seen this app from Andrea, this menu would have evolved a lot. And this is just to showcase that our Grandmaster team has been constantly upgrading this app with the best practices. It isn't called iterating like a Grandmaster for any reason. It's exactly because of this. So here you can select the problem type. These are the different ones that are currently supported. I'm not going to go through every one of these. We'll just keep it to language modeling for now. And you can then select the first model backbone that you want to start iterating over. So it can be a 7 billion model, a 13 billion model, any model that you'd like. You can also load in your previous fine-tuned backbone here and go from there. From here, all settings that you would care about for fine-tuning are A, just a slider, or B, a simple drop-down. So I can make sure the data set has been selected correctly, all the columns have been identified. Yes, they have been. Then I can look at the tokenizer settings. I can select the maximum length of the prompt, the answer. And I can also add prompt answer tokens if the data set isn't formatted correctly. From here, the fine-tuning part is also very straightforward. I can decide if I want to fine-tune on integer 4 or integer 8, float 16, or float 32 if you have a lot of compute. But ideally, you'd be sticking around float 16 or lower precision. You can also then select all of the training settings. So the loss function, the optimizer, learning rate, all of that stuff. All configurations for LoRa. So LoRa fine tuning then become a simple slider. Once you enable LoRa, you can simply select all of these hyperparameters right here. And once you've gone through all of the options, you can then happily click run experiment and this will kick off the training. So again, Data Studio to prepare all of your data, you upload that to LLM Studio and then you create your first experiment. Now you'll get your own GPT in a matter of a few minutes or an hour, depending on how large your data set is. So if I go back to this diagram, we're at the fine-tuning stage. Now, if you'd like to perform RAG or connect your fine-tuned model over this, this is Enterprise H2O GPT. And here I can create collection of my documents. I can upload my documents and perform RAG over them. So the way I do that is I create a collection and I'll say just an ML paper because I'm going to upload just an ML paper here. This is just for a demo. But I'd also love to make a point that this application scales really well across thousands, hundreds of thousands of documents. So I'll create this collection. This would be the homepage of the collection. I can add as many documents I'd like here, and I can also configure the settings. So I can set the system prompt here. I can decide if I want to perform RAG, hide RAG, RAG plus. You can see there are quite a few options to play with around here. You can also set the RAG prompt before the RAG context is provided to the retrieval model and also the prompt that's provided to the model after retrieving the chunks. So all of this can be configured right here in this menu. I'm quite happy with it, so I'll just keep it to default. Let's upload a paper from my computer. So I'll just upload the first PDF that shows up here and I'll click add. Now, this is sort of a funny demo because this application is designed to work with thousands of documents, with corrupt files, files of different formats, all that thing. Here, I'm just uploading a PDF. And what it's doing right now is preparing and storing this effectively so that then I can perform RAG over it. While that happens, you can also create your own API key here. So if you'd like to interface with H2O GPT-E, you can also do that through the API. So I can create an API key and then work right inside a Python environment. So if you remember, again, going back here, the GenAI apps that live over the API level, so to speak, this is where Enterprise H2O GPT also enables that. And LLM Studio also has a nice API offering. If you'd like to check it out, again, please go to the GitHub page. We'll take a look at the LLM apps in the next video. So you can see now that it's been processed and indexed, I can then create a chart over it. And I'll just click new chart. I'm ready to chart over it. Please summarize. So this will work. This is sort of a dummy demo, but you can imagine you can have a lot of policy documents, different cooperation documents stored inside of here, and all of that should work out of the box. I don't even know what paper I had uploaded here, but it's... So you can see it summarized the paper right here. And I can also take a look at the LLM prompt, how this happened, which parts of the paper did it take a look at. You can also monitor all of that right here. This is, again, a simple example because it's just one paper, right? But H2O GPT e-scales really well across many more documents. So this would be the RAG offering in this diagram. So we've taken a look at data prep, fine-tuning, and RAG. Now we'll take a look at evaluation. Just to remind all of you, H2O LLM eval is hosted publicly at evalgpt.ai. Andrea had covered this in a lot of depth, but you can see this provides the ELO rating leaderboard of all of the current open source ecosystem. So you can monitor which open source model we think is best given at any time. And you can get a simple leaderboard of all of these models that we try to maintain quite regularly. If you need to understand how this works, please watch the detailed walkthrough that Andrea had done for all of you. But this would be the evaluation stage. So now to recap, once again, we've gone from unstructured documents to fine-tuning our model and also performing RAG over them, and then evaluating how well does our LLM perform. In the next video, we'll take a look at some examples of GenAI apps. And I'll try to explain how they work in the wild.